Today, I'm going to talk about geometry of toposis. So, more specifically, I will come back on first on some notions which were already introduced and studied in the previous talk by Borse. And as yesterday, there will be some overlap, which means I shall repeat the same thing in slightly different terms. And I shall also introduce other things. So I will talk about morphism of toposis, which, as Borse explained, is a huge generalization of the notion of continuous map, corresponds to the notion of continuous map between topological spaces, or vibrations in a geometric context. So, secondly, there will be points. I will also, so this will be overlap, but then I will talk about subtoposis, about localization, and about what people call the classifying toposis of an inner group, which is a topos associated to G, an inner group in a topos E. Okay? So, so this is, if you want, the so this is the topos theoretic meaning of the construction of quotients in geometry. Okay, so before I move specifically to this subject, I want to make a general comment about what we are doing and why I am using this expression geometry of toposis. So, in fact, I just want to repeat things which Grothendieck himself has written. So, he says that this invention of the notion of topos and the morphism of topos allows to go from the world of geometry to the world of categories. Okay, here you start with a geometric context, and this geometric context is usually presented, incarnated in a site together with in a category together with a site. So the first basic example is a category of open subset of a topological space, and the associated canonical topology. And then you have the associated topos, which, once again, and insist on this point, a topos does not have any other structure than a categorical structure. It is not a category plus something else, it is just a category. Nothing else inside. So we are in the world of categories. I repeat what I said. So a topos is just a category without any extra structure. There is no other structure than a categorical structure on a topos. But once again, by definition of a topos, it has some very specific properties, which are all the usual constructive properties of the category of sets. Same. Okay. But so, when you say this, it looks, in fact, quite incredible, because we move from the world of geometry, which, for instance, includes the world of continuous structures, to the world of categories, so an algebraic world, which, a priori, seem, for instance, very far away from the consideration of continuous structures. So it is extremely striking. And then Grothendieck makes the comment that every time in mathematics, we have a translation, a process which allows to go from one word with its specific intuitions, language, and so on, to another word, this is extremely interesting and powerful. Okay? Here we go from the world of geometry to the world of categories. Okay? So this means that to any geometric object or to any geometric context, we are able to associate another object which do not belong to the same world, but it, which in fact incarnates everything which is important here. So this is the starting point, but it is not the whole story. Why is this correspondence very interesting? It is because when we consider all the important geometric notions, we discover that it is possible to translate these notions, these intuitions, in the world of topoesis, only using the language of categories. So this is really incredible. So in fact, we have already seen that. The first thing is the notion of continuous map, or more generally, vibration. Okay, you have a space, whatever meaning you gave to this word, you may have many different meaning of space. You have topological space, differential variety, analytic variety, I don't know what. There are many, many different types of spaces. But every time you have a specific geometric theory with the spaces, you also have a notion of vibration. And when you have a notion of vibration, you are able to interpret this vibration in the world of topoesis as a morphism of topoesis. So this means you have two topoesis, E and E prime, okay? And what is a morphism of topoesis? It was already defined by Borse in the previous talk. It is just a pair of functors, okay? The direct image functor, which is right adjoint, which goes from E to E prime, and then the reverse image functor, which goes in the other direction. And as they are adjoint, this one has to respect arbitrary limits. This one respects arbitrary co-limits. But in the definition, you add the fact that this has to respect also finite limits. And why does this definition, what was this definition given by Grothendieck? It is because anytime you are in a geometric context with a notion of vibration, then there is an induced morphism of the associated topoesis consisting of such a pair of adjoint functors where the left adjoint is exact, respects finite limits. And of course, as I said, also arbitrary collimits because it is a left adjoint. Okay, and in fact, for instance, if you consider the consideration, you consider topological spaces, it also works in the other direction. When you have two topological spaces with the associated topoesis and an associated morphism of topoesis to a continuous map given between these topological spaces, then you can recover the map for in the case your topological spaces are nice enough, in the case they are sober, which is an extremely general situation. So this means that you have translated the notion of vibration in the language of categories. You see that in the definition of the notion of a morphism of topoesis, everything is phrased in categorical terms. You have a pair of functors, so certainly the notion of functor is a categorical notion. You require this pair of functors to be adjoint one to the other. This is a categorical notion. And you require the left adjoint functor to respect finite limits. And this is, once again, a categorical definition. Okay, so this means that you have translated the notion not only of space, but of vibration, of one space over another space in categorical language. Okay? And by now, Borse has also explained the same for points. Okay? Certainly, it is a very important notion in geometry. When you have a point belonging to a space, then it is possible to associate to it a morphism of toposis from the topos of sets to the topos associated to your space X. And in many situations, it is a one-to-one correspondence. When you consider such a morphism of toposis, then it comes from a point of the space you are considering. And in fact, if it is not the case, most often, it means that your space did not have enough points, that you have to formally add new points. For instance, if you consider an algebraic variety defined just as a set, for instance, an algebraic variety over C, okay, and you only consider the points with coordinates in C, you consider the associated topos, okay, and then you look at the points of this topos. And in this way, you are led to add to the points with values in C all the Zariski points. Okay, you didn't make any choice. This is the theory does that for you. Okay? Okay, and then later I will talk about other notions which are extremely important geometric notions. So the notion of subspace, of a space, the notion of localization, which is something extremely important, of course, and the notion also of quotient by a group acting on something. Yes?
Before you move on, so you mentioned how a continuous map in some notion of space becomes a morphism of topos.
Yes.
But you also said it was a vibration.
I use the word vibration in a very general sense, because I am not talking about a specific geometric theory. In fact, in any geometric context, you can think about topological spaces, about differential varieties, about analytic varieties, about p-adic varieties, about I don't know what. You always have a notion, not only a notion of space, but a notion of vibration. But what is remarkable is, whatever the kind of geometry you are studying, you are always able to associate to this geometry toposis. Okay, so this means that here you have a huge diversity of geometric theories, but they can all be phrased in terms of toposis, which means in geometry, in categorical terms. So the first extremely fascinating fact is the fact that you are able to go from the world of geometry with all its specific intuition to the world of categories. And, in this way, you don't lose the usual important notions which you use all the time in geometrical context. So I have listed the first one of them. But it is this is interesting, not only because you were able to go from one language to another language, but also because of the fact that translating the basic geometric notions in categorical terms, which always have meaning for any topos, then you enlarge in a huge way the power of geometry. Because anytime you have a geometric context, here, the usual geometric context, once again, topological spaces, varieties in the different meanings, there is an associated topos. But there are many more toposis than the toposis coming from these specific geometric theories. So this means that you discover that geometry is much larger that what you were used to think, okay? And once you have the language here, you are once you have this translation, for instance, the topos-theoretic definition of morphism or the topos-theoretic notion of point, then you are able to apply these notions to all toposis. including toposes you are usually not used to think about in geometric terms, such that, for instance, the topos of objects endowed with an action of a group or with an action of a monoid, or it is much more general. Okay. So, I continue with the general commands. So, here, once again, for all these notions, maybe I can begin to write on for the definition for these different notions. So, for the notion of morphism, it was already defined, and also for the notion of sets. By now, there is a notion of subtopos. What is a subtopos? You have a topos E, and you are looking, you would want to know what is a topos E prime. So certainly, it should be a topos about that topos. So this means that here, there should be a morphism consisting a morphism of toposes consisting of a pair of adjoint functors, and this one has to be exact, okay, to preserve not only colimits, but also finite limits. And then, here is, I immediately give the definition of subtopos. When do we say that this is a subtopos? It is when this functor, the direct image functor from E prime to E, is fully faithful. It is a definition. So fully faithful means that for any objects E1 and E2 in E prime, the morphism from E1 to E2 correspond one-to-one to the morphism between their transforms by the direct image functor for any E1, E2. This is the definition of fully faithful. And so the definition of subtopos by Grothendieck is the fact that this functor has to be fully faithful. So once again, you can marvel at the simplicity of these definitions. All these definitions are incredibly simple. Okay? And of course, in order, why is this definition given? It is because in the case where E is the topos of sheaves on a topological space X, and Y is a subspace of X, so this means a subset of X endowed with the induced topology. So in that case, the associated topos to the topos associated to the subspace is a subtopos of the topos of sheaves on the space. And in fact, it works in the other direction, which means that if you have the topos of sheaves on a topological space, and you consider a subtopos with this definition, then this subtopos is the topos of sheaves on a subspace of X. So if there are no enough subset in X, it may happen that there are several subspaces which induce the same subtopos. But in fact, in this family of subspaces, there is always a canonical one which induces this subtopos. And in general, for instance, on the Hausdorff space, the subspace Y is uniquely determined. Okay? So this means that once again, you have translated the geometric notion of subspace in the world of toposes with a definition which is framed in purely categorical terms. You have a morphism which was already defined, and you just add the requirement that the direct image functor is fully faithful. And once again, you see this definition is purely categorical. So once again, I would want you to marvel at these facts. You are going from one world to another world. It is incredible that it is possible to phrase these geometric notions in categorical terms. It is really a miracle of mathematics. Yeah.
I have a question. Does it work? Yes. Does the microphone work?
Oh, maybe there is. No, another one is coming. So, okay, so the other one is good. So,
prova, prova.
Okay. I have a question regarding that statement at the bottom. Yeah. I was of the impression that it's false. For instance, take for X the reals with the usual topology. Then consider the sheaf topos of it, and then consider its largest dense subtopos for the double negation sheaves.
Yeah.
What would be the corresponding space Y?
Okay, so I don't. Okay, I need to think about that.
Yeah.
But.
It's true for locales, right? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Olivia just said that the statement becomes true if we imagine X and Y to be locales. But if we restrict to topological spaces, then
okay,
it's
so
in general.
Okay, so you are saying I made a slightly wrong statement.
Yeah,
so,
I mean, because you see the relationship between topological spaces and topologies is slightly. It's not perfect.
Yeah.
You really, in some sense, I mean, a Grothendieck topos is a generalization of a locale, not of a topological space. So, strictly speaking, technically. So
okay, so maybe I made the wrong statement. So there is this definition of subtopos, and so by now there is the fact that for any subspace of the given space, the associated topos of sheaves is a subtopos of the associated sheaf. So by now I want to go to point D, localization. So localization in the world of topologies is something extremely simple. You are in a topos, okay, and you consider an object of the topos, and then the statement is that this relative category, which is a category of morphism from E prime to E, okay, the objects of the category are the morphism from some object E prime of E to E, and the morphism between this type of objects are just the commutative triangles like that in E, and so the statement is that this relative category is also a topos.
I have a question. I missed that. So the point is, when you define this, for every vibration or geometry, there is a corresponding topos. So I don't know. Means if there is a specific example, suppose you have a topos, but that topos corresponds to two different spaces, in geometrical spaces. Means does this kind of example exist? Means.
No, so usually, it was already been mentioned that different sites may give rise to the same topos. But usually in geometry, in the usual geometric theories, so when you have two different spaces, they give rise to different topologies.
No.
This is just because of the reason we gave. So usually when you have a morphism between two topologies, then there is an induced morphism between the spaces you started with.
So that does that mean that if you have a topos, then with some condition, there is an unique site that corresponds to that?
No. If you are in a specific geometric context.
Specific geometric context. So it may happen that suppose we have a pathological space and you have a corresponding topological topos, And then if I can get back to some other good space, and by somehow they are related, this pathological space. And
yeah, for okay. Of course it can happen, and I think Olivia will talk about that.
So okay.
okay, but yeah, so here you have the fact that the relative category associated to a topos is also a topos. Okay, so of course the first example is when you take a topological space X, okay, and in X you have an open subset U, okay, you have the associated topos EX, and of course you can look at U as an object of EX, because U is an object in the category of open subsets. Then it is this object can be transformed into a pre-sheaf by the Yoneda functor, and it can be sheafified, so it becomes a sheaf, and this sheaf is an object of this topos. And so, so let's denote it L of U, okay? And you may wonder, what is this local topos? Is it just the topos associated to the open subspace U? Okay, so this notion of localization, you see, is a generalization of localization in the usual sense. Okay, but then it is a general theorem that that inside the topos, all the relative categories are toposes. Okay, and also when you have a morphism in a category between two in a topos between two objects, then there is an induced morphism of toposes, okay? Not only a functor, but this is really a morphism of toposes between these relative toposes, okay? So once again, we have, you see, we are going from a geometric language to a topos theoretic language, which means to a categorical language. So here, maybe I can make a remark about the way these relative categories are proved to be toposes. So suppose your topos, first, suppose it is a pre-sheaf topos, a topos of pre-sheaves on the category A. So your object is a contravariant functor going from A opposite to sets. Okay? And then there is something which has already been introduced by Borceux, which is the so-called category of elements of this functor. Okay, so how did you denote it, the category? I denote it in this way. Yeah. Well. Yeah. So this is a category of elements of E. So what does this mean? It means the objects of this category are pairs. The first element of the pair is an object. Oh, okay, so maybe I... where are the erasers? Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay, so the category of you have E, a contravariant functor from A opposite to sets, and by now, yeah, maybe I take another one, you have the category of elements, so the objects are pairs, so here A is an object of the category A, and X is an element of E of A. Is an okay, E of A is a set, so you choose an element. And what is a morphism between two such pairs? So it is a morphism in the category A, such that it's transformed by the functor F thanks X2 to X1. So this is this is an extremely important, extremely simple, but extremely important categorical construction. And so, if your topos is the topos of presheaves, then the relative category is the category of presheaves on the category of elements of E. It is just abstract nonsense. Please check it. Okay? And by now, if E is the category of sheaves for some topology J, then J induces a topology on the category of elements. You just decide that the covering sieves here become covering sieves there. And then you have that the relative category is the category of sheaves for the induced topology. Okay, so this is very basic, but it is an illustration of two facts. So the first fact is that once again, we can translate a geometric very important process, the process of localization in categorical terms, the first thing. And the second thing is that when we perform this type of basic geometric constructions in the language of toposis, we don't go out the word of toposis. The word of toposis is very stable under natural constructions. So here we see it is stable under localization. The last point I wanted to make here, the point E, is the following. So consider G an inner group of some topos E. So what is that inner group? It is an object of E which is endowed with a multiplication map, which means a morphism in the topos from G cross G to G, and an inverse map from G to G, and a unit element, which is a morphism from the final object, terminal object of the topos to G, verifying the usual axioms of group theory. Okay, so suppose you have an inner group, and you can also consider an inner monoid of E. So then you have a multiplication map, which has to be associative, and you have a unit element, but you don't necessarily have an inverse operation. Okay? So this is more general than that. And anyway, by now, you can associate to that BG or BM, which is the category of objects of E, objects, let's say, X of E, endowed with an action. So an action is a map from G cross X to X, or from M cross X to X, verifying the usual rule of actions. So the unit element has to act trivially, and the action has to be compatible with the multiplication in the group or the monoid. Okay? And so this is a category which you have defined from G or from M. And then the statement is that this category is once again a topos. You didn't go out of the world of toposis. Excuse me? Yeah, so there is a morphism. What you can do, of course, when you have an object X endowed with an action of G or an action of M, you can associate to it X itself without the action. You just forget the action. Okay. So this is a forgetful functor.
Okay.
And in fact, this forgetful functor can be interpreted as In fact, it's it can be interpreted as the pullback functor. The pullback functor from E to BG, of a topos morphism from E to BG or to BM. You can also do the following, which is when you have an object of the category, you can undo it with a trivial action. And this also can be interpreted as a pullback functor of a morphism which goes from BG to E, or from BM to M. Okay, so here, in order to understand this morphism, it is better to understand the reverse part of the morphism. So here, you take an object and you undo it with a trivial action. Here, you have an object undoed with an action, and you forget the action. So you see that the composite of these two morphisms is the identity morphism. Okay? Here, maybe I can make a remark here, because in fact, this remark gives rise to a new definition, which is extremely important in geometry. You have this functor of toposis from BG to M. And you may look as morphism, as all morphism, or the category of morphism, from E to BG, such that the composite from E to BG to E is the identity morphism of E to itself. You see, here this part is fixed. It is just undoing an object with the trivial action. But by now you wonder about all the morphism from BG to E which verify these properties. So for instance, if E is a category of sets, is a topos of sets, you are just wondering about the points of the classifying topos of G. And you wonder what are these morphisms. And I can tell you what they are. They are the right torsors of G. So what is a torsor? It is an object of the topos endowed with a right action. Okay. This action has to be a principal action. So what does it mean? It means that if you consider, so here it is A, you consider this morphism, so the first component is A, and the second component is just the projection of T cross D to G. So you want this to be an isomorphism. This is the notion of free transitive action in a general topos. So this is the third condition. And the last condition is that the canonical morphism from T to the terminal object of the topos is an epimorphism. So this is the definition of a torsor. When you look at your topos as a topos of the topos of sheaves on a site, a torsor is just what people call a principal bundle, a principal G bundle. Excuse me? No, so here I put this definition.
Excuse me, you can ask the commentator, just ask the microphone.
So the question is the torsor of G acts freely.
But in this sense.
In this sense, but when you translate to principal bundle, the action can be non-free. Means G can act on the base space and give rise to some singular fiber.
Okay, so for me, a principal action is a free action. But
okay.
So anyway, here I gave a precise definition, and with this precise definition, there is an equivalence of categories between the categories of torsors and the categories of morphism, which verify this condition.
Okay. So it does not.
So it says when you are considering the classifying topos of an inner group, I think that the consideration of this morphism is more interesting than the consideration of the points of this topos.
No, my question is, corresponding to this topos, there can be some singular action. Means it may happen that it corresponds to some singular action and singular fiber.
No, so here the fibers are, the only question when you are consider, you have a torsor, of course, what can happen is that on an object of the category, for instance, on an open subset, there is no section.
Okay. Uh-huh.
If there is one section, it becomes isomorphic to G.
Okay.
But if there is no section, you see, it is the notion of it can be globally non-trivial.
Okay.
But it is locally trivial because of this condition plus this one.
Okay.
This one says there is an open cover where your torsor becomes trivial.
Okay.
It is locally trivial, but not globally trivial.
Okay.
Thank you. So we have these notions. You see, so the first marvelous thing is that you can translate all these basic geometric notions in categorical terms. But you see that when I say categorical terms, another remark has to be made. It is the fact that all these categorical notions we have used in order to give topos theoretic equivalents of the geometric notions, all these notions are invariant under equivalence of categories. It is extremely important. Okay? So, here, there is a general principle I want to state. So, in fact, this general principle, for me, was stated completely explicitly by Olivia. But I have immediately to say that this principle, in fact, can be seen everywhere in the work of Grothendieck. So what is this principle? It is the following. You are considering invariants of toposes. Okay, and these toposes are defined in general as associated to sites, Aj. Okay, and here what we call invariants are just categorical notions. Which are invariant under equivalences of categories. And everything we have said is like that. Okay? And by now, a general principle, which for me was phrased by Olivia, is the fact that when you have an invariant, you should look at how it can be expressed in presentation sites or presentation theories, because as Borse has already begun to explain, toposes can also be expressed from theories. Okay? So this means you have an invariant and you want to express it in terms of presenting sites. Okay? And so this is an extremely general principle. So as far as I know, it was never written like that by Grothendieck. But Grothendieck has done that repeatedly without phrasing it as a general principle. In fact, I maybe at this point, before moving more specifically to the geometric notions under consideration, I can add that Olivia has added another principle she will lecture about. It is the fact that when you have an invariant, and here you have different presentations for the same topos, then you should look at the way the invariant is phrased in the different presentations, and it can give you correspondences or equivalences phrased in different languages, which can be extremely surprising, deep, new. And so this is really, so I really think this idea is a great idea. And it has already been introduced and studied by Olivia, but I am absolutely sure that much more is to be done in this direction and can be done. And this is really an extremely interesting point of view. But so the basis for this second principle is this first principle, that when you have an invariant, you should be able to phrase it in terms of presentations. So what is behind this principle? It is the fact that first, all the important notions, especially the geometric notions, the notions which are more important for us and which are more, the intuition which are more powerful for us, are topos theoretic invariants. Okay? They are invariants of toposes phrased in categorical terms and stable under equivalence of categories. So this is the first principle. But the problem, of course, is that a topos, a Grothendieck topos, is a huge object. It is too big. You cannot, you never hold a topos in your hands. You see, the most simple topos is a topos of sets. And that's really too big. And the other toposes are even bigger, so you see. Of course, the theory becomes interesting when you are able to compute with this theory. And in fact, it is really a very important information, a general information, that you can compute with toposes. When you are an invariant, you are able to compute this invariant. And how to compute this invariant, how to work with invariants, you always represent, you always consider presentations of these toposes, presentation from sight or presentation from theories, because these are concrete combinatorial data, and you may work on them either by yourself or even with a computer. There is a computer dimension in this whole thing. Okay? So this means that the notions are topos theoretic, but the process to work on the notions is by considering presentations of the sites and expressing the notions in terms of the presentation sites. So, in fact, we can do that for the different notions under consideration. You see, I apply this general principle, and applying this general principle in the different cases I have written on the blackboard, we immediately find parts of what has been explained by Borse in the last lecture. Because what did Borse do? So first, there is a consideration of morphism of toposes. So you have a topos, which is a topos of sheaves on some site, AG. Okay? And then you wonder about what is a morphism from an arbitrary topos E to this topos presented by a site. So of course, a most important case is the case when E is the topos of sets, and then we are talking about points. So the first remark to be done is the fact that in a pair of functors, if you know one of the functors, you know the other functor. Because when a functor has an adjoint, this adjoint is unique up to unique isomorphism. So this means that in order to know this pair of functors, we only need to know F upper star from this topos to that topos. Then you may wonder, when does such a functor has an adjoint? In fact, we have said it yesterday. We said that when we have a morphism from a topos to an arbitrary category, this morphism has a right adjoint if and only if it preserves colimits. So what we need here, in order to be able to form this topos, to form this morphism of topos, we need, and it is completely equivalent, we need a functor from this topos to that topos, which preserves arbitrary colimits and finite limits. Okay, so you see we have reduced the construction of a pair of functors to the construction of one functor. Okay, so by now, of course, we are working on this, and we have the Yoneda functor from the underlying category A to the pre-sheaf category, and then here we have the sheafification functor. Okay, so if we have such a map, such a functor F, then certainly we can compose F with L to get a functor from A to E, which is much more amenable, of course, because A, you see, it is a small category. Once again, a topos is too big, but A is manageable. You cannot compute directly with A j hat, but you can compute with A. So by now, you wonder, when you have such a functor from A to E, first, is it possible to extend it? Is it possible to extend it to a functor from this topos to that topos? And if it is possible, is the extension unique? These are the two obvious questions. So first, it is unique. Why it is unique? It is unique because this functor has to preserve colimits, and in this topos, all objects are colimits of representable objects. So it is, in fact, a very important fact. So this is the first part of the lemma. In the topos, in the category of pre-sheaves, any pre-sheaves is the colimit of the representable pre-sheaves associated to the objects of the category, indexed by the category of elements. You see, once again, the category of elements appears. Okay? And so if you apply that, so this is true for any pre-sheaf. So this is an exercise. Please check this fact. This is one of the most, it is the most important fact in the theory of pre-sheaves. Please check it. It takes 3 lines, okay? So please do it and learn it by heart. Okay, so then if F is a sheaf, just because the sheafification functor preserves arbitrary colimits, we have the following derived formula. Okay. Any object, any sheaf is a colimit of representable sheaves. So this means, as a consequence, it means that if this functor has an extension, the extension is unique. So by now, suppose you have a functor from A to some topos E, or even a category C with arbitrary colimits. Okay. So then the second part of the lemma is that this functor extends in a unique way to a functor from A hat to E, which respects, so this, I can denote this way, this is what Borse has called the Kahn extension. So LAN is because it is a left adjoint of something. But anyway, so it is a unique extension, okay? The unique extension of rho preserving all colimits. And the definition of rho hat, if it exists, is very simple. So it has to be the limit over the elements, over the category of elements of some pre-sheaf F of rho of A. Okay, so if this extends rho and preserves colimits, it has to be given by this formula. Then you have to check that this, which is well defined already as a functor, preserves colimits. So please, this also, please check it as an exercise. Okay, and I give you an indication, it is just a consequence of the fact that colimits commute with colimits. Yes?
Sorry, I might be wrong, but in this lemma, aren't you using the topology subcanonical?
No, here there is no topology in this lemma.
Yes, but in some sense...
I am talking about pre-sheaves. So the underlying topology is a discrete topology. I am talking... You see, I only consider a category A and the category of pre-sheaves on A. There is no topology. Now, here I have a functor from A to some topos, or more generally...
Yes, there.
Oh, yes, no, but this is a remark. It is a remark. Okay, so this is in,
yes, but in some sense,
AJ for any J. And it is just an obvious consequence of this fact. It is a remark. It is a side remark.
No, no,
okay?
Yes,
but
course.
Here, the lemma, the content of the lemma, is about pre-sheaves.
No, no, of course, but when you use that, the map that you get is unique. You said that there is a unique map and the diagram commutes.
If you
want that the diagram commutes...
Yeah, but this is because... I am composing Y with the sheafification functor. I want a functor from A at J to E.
Yes.
So here, if I want to say it is unique, I have to use this fact.
Yes,
this is why I made this remark.
This is what I'm claiming. Are you sure you're not using that here J is subcanonical?
No, not at all. I am using the fact that the sheafification functor preserves arbitrary colimits.
Okay.
That's all. Okay, so we have this unique extension, the Kahn extension, okay, and so please check as an exercise that it preserves arbitrary colimits. So this means that if we come back to this situation, so you see, the initial question is whether a given functor from rho to A extends... extends to the sheaf category. So we would want something like that. Of course, if it extends like this, it should factorize in this way. Okay? So here we have some functor rho, and we already know that there is a unique extension to A hat making this triangle commutative. And so the question is whether this thing factorizes like that, and whether the factorization preserves finite limits. So, in order for this to factorize, we need any covering sieve here to be sent to an isomorphism. Or, if you prefer, we want any covering family here for the topology J to be sent to an epimorphic family. Okay, so people call, so it has already been introduced by Borse, and the name is people call that G. Say that rho is J continuous. So what does it mean? It means that any covering sieve becomes an isomorphism. Or, if you prefer, any covering family becomes epimorphic. So here, in fact, when I say, you see, Borse had only said that, and here I am adding this remark, because here there is something important to know about topologies, which is the following. It is a general remark, which could have been done yesterday. So the remark is the following. So you are in A with the topology J, and you are considering a family of morphism to some fixed object A. Okay? And then you have the sieve generated by the AIs. So what does it mean? It is the smallest sieve containing the AIs. So it is the sieve of euros from A prime to A, which factorize through at least one of the euros we have been considering. One of the euros FIs, okay? So this sieve is called the sieve generated by this family. And you say that a family is a covering family okay, so you say this is a covering family. It corresponds, it is a generalization of the notion of cover, an open cover, covering family, if and only if the generated sieve belongs to J of A. And then you have a very important fact about topologies, which is the following. It is the fact that this is equivalent to the fact that the associated families of maps of morphism by the canonical functor L is globally epimorphic. It is an equivalence. It is not obvious, okay? But it is a very important notion to know about topologies. Okay. So here you have this notion of J continuity, which allows you to factorize like this. And the last thing you do is you want this functor to preserve finite limits. As you know, this functor preserves finite limits. It is equivalent to know that the functor rho hat preserves finite limits. So you see, it is independent of the topology J. And this is the notion. So rho hat preserves limits is equivalent to what Borse has called flatness. Okay? So here, you see, we have transformed the notion of morphism between two topologies, which is an extremely well defined notion, extremely nice, extremely beautiful. We have transformed this notion into a notion expressed in terms of presentation size with which you can work. So to express morphism in terms of presentation size is extremely important. On the same, of course, a particular case of that is the case of points. And the last thing I want to say is for port C, the notion of subtopos of a topos. You see, so what is a subtopos? I said it is a pair, it is a morphism of toposes such that this is fully faithful. By definition. Yes.
The question is this flat
yes.
functor you're talking about, is it so since it's a covering, so does this the same we see in algebraic geometry that it preserves the dimension
yes.
of the fibers?
Yes, so yeah. In fact, here it should be remarked that if A has arbitrary finite limits, so under this condition, it is equivalent to rho preserves finite limits. So in algebraic geometry, we are working on categories which have finite limits. So flatness in that case is just the fact that rho preserves finite limits. So it is very concrete and simple. But even in categories which don't have finite limits, this is a workable notion. Once again, good notions, so a basic principle of topos theory, is that good notions are defined at the topos theoretic level and should be invariant under equivalences of categories. But this notion can be computed and can be worked on using presentation by size. So you have this duality between toposes and presentations. And you should certainly not forget presentations because you cannot work directly on toposes. On toposes, what you can do is to imagine invariance. Okay? You see, all these definitions given by Grothendieck are definitions at the topos theoretic level. Grothendieck had the idea to define morphism like this, points like that, and so on. But then, in order to work within these notions, you have to know what it means at the presentation level. Yes.
So, since you were saying at the level of presentation, as Olivia said this, but so my point is, I like to know that since we know this theory of invariance coming from group representations, so is there any? So is it the same spirit that you have this presentation when you have this categorical notion of invariance, then you have a
yeah.
Site?
You see, when you have a group, so there is a most natural topos associated to that, which is the topos of actions of this group.
Yes.
Okay. And in fact, good notions associated to this group are notions associated to the topos of actions of this group.
Okay.
And in fact, it is not only something theoretical, it comes back, in fact, to the invention of groups. If you look at the original text by Galois, uh-huh. which yeah. introduces groups, in fact, Galois doesn't talk about groups. He talks about groups acting on objects.
Yeah.
And this is really what we are interested in. In mathematics, we don't bother about groups. We bother about groups acting on something. So which means what is interesting is not the group itself, it is the associated topos. So inside this topos, there are many types of objects. For instance, there are linear objects. And the linear objects, which are you can talk about linear objects in any topos, but in particular in the topos associated to a group. And what it is a category of representations of your group, of linear representations of your group, which is a most important object of study in mathematics. So the last thing I wanted to say, because I think I am going please stop me, but I think that... Okay, so the last thing I wanted to say is that there is this notion of subtopos, and of course, we have already seen some instances of subtopos, because if, for instance, you take E, the topos of presheaves on a category, and you take for E prime the category of sheaves for some topology J, then certainly this is a subtopos of that. Because E prime, in fact, is defined as the full subcategory of the category of presheaves consisting of sheaves. So the direct image functor, by definition, is fully faithful. But then there is a theorem here which tells you you have nothing else. Which means that to consider a subtopos of E is the same thing, of E equal A hat, is the same thing as to consider a topology J on your category. And of course, there is a natural ordering on both sides, and this correspondence reverses the order. The bigger the topology, the smaller the subtopos. Okay? And so, as an immediate corollary of that, you see that subtoposes of a given topos make up a set, which was not at all obvious, because here you have a huge object. And you are talking about sub-objects of a huge object. So a priori, it was not clear at all, it was a set. But it is equivalent to topologies on the given category, which is a small category. So it is a set, an ordered set. And in fact, not only it is an ordered set, but it is an Eytig algebra. So this means we have intersections, we have union, we have distribution laws, and we can take the complement of it in a co-Eytig algebra. So this means if we have two subtoposes, E prime and E second, we can take another topos, which is E prime minus E second. Okay, the dual operation of the implication operation, which already appeared in the talk by Borse. Okay, so we have this correspondence, and you see, once again, it is always the same story. We have a topos theoretic notion expressed here in terms of presentations. So here, of course, a consequence of that, I should say, is that if E is not a presheaf topos, but a general topos, so the equivalence is with topologies which contain the given topology. So here, you see, once again, it is not so difficult to prove it. It is not at all trivial either. You need one or two pages, and it is quite an intricate reasoning. But once again, it is a really remarkable fact that you can express this purely categorical, this purely topos theoretic notion in terms of presentations. And so, experience shows, and certainly Olivia has told that to me many times, and of course it completely agrees with what I had learned in algebraic geometry. It is the fact that when you are considering invariants of toposes, the general rule is that you are able to express that in terms of presentations. It is never trivial. It can be tricky, but usually it is doable. But for instance, even the most important theorems which were proved by Grothendieck and which made algebraic geometry an extremely powerful theory. So the big theorems proved by Grothendieck have this type. So probably the most important theorem in the so-called theory of Ethal cohomology is the fact that when you consider an algebraic variety defined over a finite field, then the trace of the Frobenius endomorphism acting on the cohomology is, so the alternate trace, is equal to the number of points of your variety with coefficients in your finite base field. So you see, we are talking about the trace of the Frobenius endomorphism acting on cohomology. This is a topos-theoretic invariant. You see? And the statement is that this topos-theoretic invariant is equal to the number of points of the underlying variety with values in some field. And this is an information. This is expressed in terms of the underlying site. So in fact, this is the deepest theorem I know relating a topos-theoretic invariant in concrete site presentation terms. Okay, I think I am already over time. And so this afternoon, my last talk will be about the canonical topology, which Borceux has already introduced yesterday, but I will give the definition again. And I will try to convince you that this topology is especially interesting. And once again, it is a fascinating notion. So.